We're going to kick off with Marvin sharing updates on a couple of things, and then we'll hand the floor over to you all for questions. So Marvin, if you're ready, would you like to start?
Yeah, thank you, and welcome everyone. So just to start with just a bit of a COVID update. So as of Tuesday, our city case rate was 29 new cases per 100,000 people over the last 7 days. It's below the national average, which is at 41 new cases per 100,000, but obviously it's an increase in numbers. We are still of the position whereby we are hopeful but cautious. We expected, as well, I've stressed a number of times, the numbers of cases to go up because we are easing lockdown and people are coming into greater contact with us. But we also know that the Delta variant is more infectious, also. So that is playing itself out, hence some of the uncertainty with the national guidance at the moment. As of the 2nd of June, we had 59 cases of the Delta variant found in Bristol. There have been no severe illness or hospitalization in relation to that variant, and a number of cases in families, but there are a number of cases in families and younger children, which is affecting schools. So the track and trace is in place and has proved successful in identifying cases and managing cases. Many of our cases have actually been identified through rapid testing as well. So we are urging people to continue with the rapid testing as a way of helping keep us all safe. On vaccinations in Bristol, North Somerset and South Gloucestershire, we've given out over 1 million first and second dose vaccines now. 54% have had at least one jab. 41 of Bristol's adult population have had both doses. That's 57% in North Somerset, 53% in South Gloucestershire. Bristol has a younger population, which means mainly only eligible people then receiving that jab. The COVID-19 vaccines are now open to those aged 25 and over, and you can book your vaccine through an NHS website. Or by calling 119. So we are continuing to urge people, obviously, to take the vaccine as soon as they are offered. This week we launched a new campaign going under the hashtag Get Tested for Bristol. And it's been led by our young people from across the nighttime and music sectors, sports, youth clubs, and our Bristol's popular drag scene, and it's sharing messages of encouragement and support to encourage regular rapid testing. Posts are going to be shared across the council social media channels have started to be shared now. We're asking people to take those and repost them to help us get the message out. So up to a third of people with COVID-19 are asymptomatic and could be spreading it without knowing, so the rapid testing helps us get in there to identify people who are carrying but asymptomatic, and therefore we are in a position to break the chains of infection. To get tests, you'll know all the places: the Rapid Testing Centre, Wellington Road, just off the M32, local pharmacies, collection sites from 2:30 p.m. every day at Hengrove Leisure Centre and Netham Park Victoria Rooms, your employer, school or college, and gov.uk. were also ways to get hold of the rapid testing. And support is available to anyone who tests positive for coronavirus through the We Are Bristol helpline on 0800 694 0184. Very important that we continue to remind people that while we are a year into the pandemic, the We Are Bristol helpline is still going, to there to offer support to people who need it. I guess the other piece of big news is that the Colston statue has been on display. So far, we've had 2,040 people attend with over 8,000 views online. And we've had 3,000 responses to the survey. Obviously, visitor numbers are restricted by COVID, which limits the capacity, but most slots are full and we are accepting walk-ins when we have a space. But as yet, it's been well received. I really want to congratulate those in our culture team and the We Are Bristol History Commission for all the work they've done around the Colston statue and the exhibition to make this a space where we can have a really informed, rounded conversation about the statue, the future of the plinth, but also our relationship to our city's history and our understanding of our city's history more generally as well. So that's probably enough from me. And as ever, as I say, you can ask me about any of that, or you can ask me about any other issues that are on your mind right now.
That's lovely. Thank you, Marvin. Who'd like to go first with questions? James.
Thanks. Sorry, just trying to find the unmute button. Marvin, you mentioned obviously straight up there the COVID situation in Bristol, and obviously these days generally the rate is pretty low. But I think I'm right in saying that in terms of the number of people testing positive, the latest data on the government dashboard suggests that's gone up by more than double in the last 7 days. I just wonder what your thoughts are on that. It's obviously not a great fact.
No, my thoughts on that is very much the same as they have been, James, that we have to be aware that the presence of COVID can increase very, very quickly if we're not very cautious. We've seen that before when we went from single digits up to over 500 new cases per 100,000 people. And that happened over the course of weeks. And then it went down very quickly as well. So we also know that the interventions that we've developed can be very effective. And obviously now we also have the addition of the vaccine with us as well, which is another tool we have to keep us safe. So I remain cautiously hopeful, but very careful in urging people to continue to engage in COVID safe behaviours. Well, we do our best to make sure that in the face of the easing of lockdown, or whatever stage of that easing is, that we are creating COVID safe environments.
It's interesting you mentioned that Get Tested campaign aimed at young people. Obviously this pandemic has been going on for so long now. Are you worried that because it doesn't have such a severe impact on young people that they might just not be bothered anymore about getting tested or getting vaccines potentially, things like that?
I wouldn't use the word worried, but clearly it's a consideration we have to carry that there'll be, as people believe, life is returning to normal, as people might begin to believe that the vaccine, descends upon us like an impregnable protective shield, as people just become weary with restrictions the discipline that they've followed over the last years begins to wane, and they begin to engage in more COVID risky behaviours, and that is a consideration. It's a challenge that we have to be cognizant of as a city.
Two other things, if I can, just quickly. Obviously, it's the Euros starting this weekend. Normally, that would mean pubs filling up, and people going around to friends' houses and things to watch the games. What's your message to fans in terms of how they should, watch it this year as opposed to others?
Well, in line, please. it is. I was being interviewed BCFM this morning, and just showing it is, sitting around in a big crowd, leaning on each other, watching England play. There's a fantastic opportunity there that is not going to be as available to us as it once was this time around, which is disappointing. We want people to be supporting the team. We want people to be outside, but we do need to just stress to people that large crowds increase risk. And so we just urge people to celebrate the team, commune with other people. Let's rally, but we need to keep each other safe. And it'd be fantastic to just allow to have this European Championships. The joy of an England victory at the Euros be clean, because it hasn't been associated with a huge upsurge in the rate of COVID.
Right, and just lastly, so I'm aware that won't take up too much time. Your mass transport plans. I was talking to Dan Norris the other day about not just your plans for the underground, but just the plans for transport in general. And he was saying that essentially the key thing is working out where the funding for anything you do is going to come from. What conversations have you had? Is there any update you can give us on how that's going in terms of speaking to the government and things like that?
Yeah, well, we submitted our shortlist of 19 options to government some months ago. Now, I think it's 2-3 months ago, and that's where we're on. But that's been the conversation throughout. I mean, it's been a message we've given throughout. Everything takes money, and in fact, when I talk to government, we try to talk not about funding but investment. Delivering a mass transit for Bristol is an investment in productivity, economic inclusion. There'll be thousands of jobs in the pipeline that are lined up with the delivery of it, and it's an investment in decarbonisation and increased resilience. So all these things are about investing in cities, investing in local economies, and it all takes money. But that's all part of the journey. Coming forward to government with your options and building that business case is how you end up with that partnership with DIT that then goes on to the international stage with an investment from government, but also trying to find the international investors to make the schemes workable. So that's a perfectly normal course of action.
Great, thanks, Sam. I'll leave it there.
No problem.
Thank you, James. Tom, go ahead. Amanda, I think you're there, but you've been having connection problems. If you're able to turn your video on, that would be good. Tom, go ahead.
Hi, Marvin. Yeah, you were talking on sort of the younger population in Bristol, and of course the over 25s now being able to go for their vaccines. How quickly are the sort of mass vaccination centres like Ashton Gate getting through these groups, and how are they coping now more people can go for their vaccines?
For the rates of, Tom, what I can do is go back and get a rates per day for you, a specific number, if that would help, or a rate or a numbers per week. I can go and find that. I wouldn't have that number off the top of my head. But obviously, the vaccinations have been rolled out incredibly effectively, and that whole system is still in play. And so we'd expect it to be going very well. For our job, outside of the clinicians who are running that whole process, our job is to make sure that we are playing our part in continuing to get the message out to encourage people to sign up for the vaccinations as soon as they get the offer, and then to attend the appointments when they're booked and not leave them vacant, to making sure the population are aware of this.
And in terms of pandemic recovery, I just wondered what your opinion was on the COVID catch-up plan for schools that the government released last week.
Well, I think it's insufficient, isn't it? That's widely, condemned. We started on our own education catch-up plan for the city, working with Andy Forth from City of Bristol College, looking at three strands, which was around academic catch-up, mental health, and also reaching out to those young people who have drifted out of education and unemployment without the pastoral support, but not had the pastoral support for that life transition. So an incredibly precarious life position, and that work is going on now. And I'm meeting with Andy, I think it's later this week actually, Andy Forbes again, and Josh Eggleton actually, to look at jobs in catering and hospitality as well, and training. But we did actually sign an NEU letter to government making that very point, that what has been put on the table, when you measure it against what we have been told is necessary, is wholly inadequate. Saving billions of pounds the way the government might see it now is going to cost us all in unemployment, inequality, social instability, reduced skills, mental health over the medium to long term. So it's very short-sighted.
And just finally from me, Marvin, you mentioned the Colton exhibition and the numbers that have been to see the statue. There was a campaign group called Save Our Statues who claimed they were trying to block up the booking slots. I know MSHED and the council both responded to that, but what were your thoughts on that?
Well, one is it when it hasn't worked, but if it's true. But look, I mean, I've set out since the beginning to say we need to try and understand each other to engage in a meaningful discussion around this, a random discussion. That means that for those people who are elated at the statue coming down the way that it happened, you know, we engage and we understand where people are coming from. For those who were sympathetic at it coming down but dismayed at the way it happened, we understand that view. And those who feel that Colston is somehow an integral part of Bristol's identity and they've lost a piece of themselves and their city, we also need to understand that. So our approach in Bristol is trying to understand where people are coming from, facilitate a conversation between all those very different experiences of Bristol, experiences of Colston and perspectives on the city. You know, an anti-debate approach, just trying to block people from even having a discussion, to me, is out of line with the city and is out of line with a thoughtful approach to shaping our city and our country's future.
Thanks for your time, Marvin.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. Who's next? Paul. Then Ellie.
Hi there, thank you. Can I just ask, first of all, about, not specifically COVID, but June the 21st, what do you think should happen then?
Well, I've only got a framework for that, Paul, and I think what should happen is a sober assessment is made of the level of risk that would be introduced to the country if that unlocking goes ahead in light of the, you know, the background rates. And then, you know, with all that public health expertise and modelling that is available at the national level, if the risk is too high, then clearly what we don't want is to yo-yo in and out of degrees of lockdown, then it should be delayed. If there is a belief that that modelling shows that the risk is not out of proportion to the benefits that we gain from the easing of lockdown, then we should go ahead. I would just imagine though, Paul, that that is the framework that any decision maker at the national level is working through anyway. So there's nothing new there, is it? It's will the gains and the potential outweigh the losses and the potential losses?
Just to say, I mean, the figure you gave, 29 cases per 100,000, I think the figure we got late yesterday at the BBC, and we seem to somehow be a little step ahead, but showed 41 per 100,000. So it's obviously going up fast. Yeah. What does your gut instinct say about that increase and whether that does, you know, increase? I mean, does it mean it's likely that we'll get a delay on the 21st?
Yeah, well I wouldn't be surprised if senior people in London were talking to journalists before they were actually talking to local government. That is an ongoing frustration of ours, seeing as we are leaders of place and we need our information in a timely way, but there you go, centralisation and all that. But yeah, I mean, if it would be a concern and that would feed in. If the rate is showing itself to be going up at an alarming rate, then the guidance from the you know, our public health leads and our clinicians would be to delay the unlocking. What I would say though, Paul, is that not all numbers are, you know, the numbers are there to be interpreted as well. So you'll know before that if the numbers are out there in the community, it's dangerous. If we know where the cases are and they're being managed and contained, then it's less dangerous. You can have more cases that are being managed well and there's less of a risk than, you know, a lot of unknown cases out in the community. So we'd have to, you know, I guess what the experts will be doing is looking at where those numbers are and what they actually represent and which elements of the population, as well as just the broad numbers.
Just changing subject to the other subject that was mentioned, Colston statue, a year since that came down, etc. One of the things, there's been a lot of quite reflective programming and discussion about, you know, the year since then. One of the criticisms that some campaigners have made is that not much has changed. What do you think?
Well, isn't that what I said last year? It's like, it would be naive. Well, it would be naive to have felt at the time or even since that a statue being hauled down has a direct link to changes in policy and structures of racism that have been built up over 500 years. I mean, it was, you know, that was the point that we made. And I did actually talk to someone who was very close to the hauling down of the statue at the time. And I said, okay, when a statute's come down, what specific, you know, what are the specific things you want to happen? And over the course of 2 half-hour conversations, there wasn't one policy. That's always been my point about many of the actions that have happened in Bristol, even around Kill the Bill. Yes, action's fine and protest is a part of Bristol, but it also has to be linked to specific outcomes that are being sought. There's another dynamic in that COVID has come and disproportionately hit us over the last year that has to be taken into account. By definition, it's hit the poorest and most marginalized hardest and left them least well placed to benefit from any uptick in the economy. So all of those underlying drivers driving inequality, be they race or class based, have been enforced over the course of the last year, irrespective of whether the statue was pulled down or not. So statues are hugely symbolic. They send messages and they make statements. But symbolic actions have to be underpinned by hard policy and structural change. They are not in and of themselves systemic change. What I would say, Paul, is, again, is looking at our record in being in office I won't give you the list now. We can give it to you off if you want. But the whole list of things that we've done since being in office, from stepping up to recruitment of magistrates, to the work around mental health, to housing, have all been real world interventions on inequalities in general, race inequalities in particular. I call it the hard yards of activism. You know, it's not all glamorous and tweetable. Sometimes the things that we have to do to tackle inequalities are invisible, policy led, and they happen in quiet decisions that have big implications for some of our council systems.
Thank you. One final question. We obviously heard yesterday that the Parliamentary Commission think Bristol should have, and Bristol will almost certainly get, a new parliamentary seat. Could you have a tilt at Parliament in a few years' time?
Could I have a tilt at Parliament? What, are you looking to become an agent, Paul? You got the experience. We could talk about it. I got my hands full with the city at the moment, isn't it? You know, we've got a lot going on here. And just coming off the back of the election, which by the way, is a strange experience. And I guess it's the first time we've had a mayor's been re-elected. So the scale of that interruption before coming back in, this is the first time we've ever done it. So we've essentially, you go away for about 2 months and then you come back and you've got to get your head around everything again. We're rewriting refreshing the corporate strategy, rekindling all our city priorities, looking at recovery, preparing for COP. So there's plenty going on at the moment.
You're not ruling it out. Would you like to be an MP in principle?
Well, I don't think it's a good thing to rule anything out, but life takes strange turns. Although I did rule out a third term. But life takes strange turns, so why would you rule anything out? I've said many times that being elected is not something I have to do. It's an expression. It's the expression at this point in time of what I want to do. This is a channel at this point in time that I am using to try and make the world fairer. Just as when I was at the BBC, I wanted to do stories of people that didn't have a voice, when I was in the voluntary sector, when I was in the NHS. It's just another expression of what I've always wanted to do. If parliamentary politics was one of those, then maybe some point, but it's not something I've got at the top of my to-do list.
Thank you.
Thanks, Paul. And Ellie, you said you had a question.
Yeah, I've just got a couple, if that's okay. Hi, everyone. Marvin, can I just return to education? The new cabinet structure means that education's obviously been incorporated as part of the role with families and children. And obviously it's a time when so many families are feeling the effects of the pandemic and everything. I just wondered what your thought process was behind making the cabinet changes, and also what you say to families that are concerned that they're being left behind by the system in Bristol.
By what, sorry? Left behind by?
Families that are worried about being left behind, whether that's because of the send placement situation or because their children have fallen behind during COVID.
Well, we recognise the risks of people being left behind, which that's why we launched some months ago the work with Andy and our schools and with our children's board as well, this educational recovery work. as I've said at the beginning, by definition, those in most marginal will be hit first and hardest. They'll be least well placed to benefit from any upturn in the economy. And that's going to be a legacy of COVID that we have to proactively work against. So those fears are valid fears. And as a city, we take them seriously. I mean, on SEND, we've talked about this many times, Ellie, and we've got the outside inspection coming in now, and we report back regularly, and progress against all those outcomes that have been set out is strong. And there's a lot more, there's a lot of history to SEND as well, and I think you also are aware of that predates us as well. But yeah, on the cabinet, there's always been a huge area of overlap between Helen and Anna when she had that brief. So from nursery schools to primary to mental health to families to childcare, there's always been a huge overlap. So this rationalizes that. Now Anna has needed to focus on being a full-time teacher herself and parent and partner. This just rationalizes that under the children's board, and it just makes sense.
And are there more details of the work being done to help people catch up that we can find anywhere, or are you able to provide them?
Yeah, I can go and get the work that's being worked up on that. But we're looking at a range of things, but see, we'd hope for more resource from national government, because you can't get teachers for free, you can't get after school care for free, and everything costs resource. But I can, those three prongs are, how do we take on that challenge of supporting academic catch up? We have to look at additional hours, which is what the national advisor was talking about, which we have to look at what the financial implications for this government pot mean for us, but we have to put the additional hours into that catch up. Mental health is, and the instability that have been brought to children's lives, not just through the missing out on the structure of education and the anxiety that will come, but we know there's been increased child abuse and domestic violence in the home, domestic violence and abuse in the homes as well, that will be impacting on children's educational journey. So our work with the health and wellbeing board around education and mental health and children and young people will really be taking an upturn, but that's obviously a very close conversation with the NHS. And what we're doing around apprenticeships and trying to build the inclusive economy, which is one of the reasons we're asking for government for certainty over the money for decarbonisation, so we can line up those local skills for those local jobs, is going to be absolutely essential as well, as we reach out for those people who've kind of drifted out of both education and employment into limbo. We're proactively trying to reach out to those. For example, we're meeting with Josh Eggleton to talk about training for people to go into the hospitality sector now, which is a big, big project we're hoping to roll out over the coming months.
Okay, thank you. And just one more question about the G7 coming up. What your thoughts are on the fact that it's happening and going ahead in the current climate we've got, and just anything that you'd want to see for Bristol that could come out of it?
Well, I've actually just come off a G7 call, actually, chaired by Nick Forbes, with mayors from around the world. And the heads of Commonwealth local government was on, that we are a member city, or actually we are the UK representative city on that, UK heads of local government. So, and that was the argument that the world, well, one is G7 does need to happen because the world's still happening, right? COVID is happening, but we still need to do trade. We still need to take on the challenges of climate and ecological emergency, global migration crisis, look at the power of corporations, whether they're paying their taxes and all those type of things. The point we've been making is that cities need to be part of that conversation. And you'll hear me say repeatedly, the world cannot be run by national governments alone. With most of the world now living in cities, people moving between cities, the climate targets only meetable if we decarbonize cities. You have to have city leaders at the table shaping national and international policy. And that two-hour meeting that finished at 2 o'clock, no, 1 o'clock, or whatever it was, it was part of that ongoing effort. And that's what we want to see more of. We certainly want to see it going into COP.
So you would rather be there than be on the outskirts?
Well, I'm just saying the voice of cities has to be central to any decisions made about how the world is run in the future. This is a missing piece. I don't personally have to be there.
Is that it, Ellie? Amanda, did you have any questions?
Yes, please. And sorry I was late. And sorry that I didn't realise I wasn't on video. I got the link secondhand and it didn't work to begin with. Yeah, so hello everyone. Because I was late, I missed the COVID numbers. So would you mind sending those to me, Sophie, in an email, if that's all right?
Yes, for sure. We will be making sure we start promptly, Amanda. So if anyone misses anything at the beginning, we'll send information across.
Yeah, sorry about that. And Marvin, I just wondered, returning to education and COVID, what are the council's plans to deal with rising COVID cases in schools as children return from half term? Does the council have any specific plans in place to deal with that?
Well, they'll be the same. There'll be a kind of an iteration of the plan of what we've been doing over the last year, which has really been working with the expertise of our schools. One of the challenges we've shared with government is every school is different. They have a different population. They have a different balance of risks. They have different buildings. And our job is to work with those head teachers, with the unions, with the teachers, to make sure that we're supporting them do what they need to do to keep their school environment safe. We'll put all our public health expertise at their disposal, which is what we've been doing.
Okay. And likewise for June the 21st, does the council have any specific plans around if restrictions do lift on the 21st? What plans does the council have to monitor and respond to what happens after that?
As in terms of, do we begin to behave differently if there's an easing of lockdown?
I suppose, yeah, in terms of will it sort of stand by, I suppose, if there is a sudden rise in cases, to step in and respond as a city?
Oh yeah, we always have an emergency response ready. We have that in general anyway, to general emergencies. But obviously the preparedness is led by our leaders in public health, and that to respond to any upsurge in cases is something that we're required to do through our various levels of command. It's not just us; it's us working with the health service and our other responsive services as well. So yeah, that will just remain in place. But then we don't do that alone. If there is an incredible surge in Bristol, that would be work that's undertaken with our national health leads as well.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, any final question? We've got a few minutes left. And if not, we'll end. And any Marvin, anything you wanted to add?
No, I think only if there's any final questions, there's nothing particularly for me at the moment.
Okay, thank you. Thanks very much for coming then, everyone, and we look forward to seeing you in the next week or two.